Thank you. Hello, good evening, everyone. First of all, welcome, everyone. Welcome to the 2020 Pemberton Lecture, sponsored by the Philadelphia Rheumatism Society. And I have the distinct pleasure of being the president of the Philadelphia Rheumatism Society this year during this unprecedented time of pandemic. So we have our guest today, our guest speaker today. We have the pleasure of having Dr. Christopher Richland. He is a professor of medicine and chief of allergy, immunology, and rheumatology at the University of Rochester Medical Center in Rochester, New York. He joined the faculty of the University of Rochester School of Medicine and Dentistry in 1991. In 2009, he earned an MPH degree at the university. He's a member of the ACR Division Director's Special Committee and also directs the mentoring of junior investigators in the group for research and assessment of psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis, acronym of GRAPPA. He has published more than 160 manuscripts on topics related to psoriatic arthritis, lymphatic mechanisms of joint flare, and bone remodeling. Everybody, please welcome Dr. Richland. Dr. Richland, you have the floor. I can't hear you. Hey, Dr. Richland, can you unmute yourself?
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, sorry about that. That muting thing always proves to be a problem. So I want to thank you for introducing me, Dr. Tan, and to let you know what a pleasure it is to speak at this renowned lectureship in the name of Ralph Pemberton. Dr. Pemberton is really remarkable for his insights and discoveries in rheumatoid arthritis, many of which, although not maybe gained traction at the time, were somewhat prescient in his interest in the role of the gut in rheumatoid arthritis really moves forward into our interest in the microbiome. His interest in the physiology and rehabilitation and dietary approaches to rheumatoid arthritis, which, as I will shortly discuss, are still at the forefront of thinking about therapeutic interventions today. But he was really present at a remarkable time. And this is outlined in a fabulous book that has gotten some press lately because of our current pandemic, called The Great Influenza by John Barry. And what's really remarkable about this book, other than how he describes how the American medical profession and also the country responds to this horrendous pandemic, which killed over 50 million people, is that it also was a time when the American medical profession was coming into true scientific revelation, if you will. And this started in 1893 with the formation of the Johns Hopkins Medical School, which was the leadership was from William Welch, a very renowned pathologist who trained in New York City. And then the formation of the Rockefeller Institute in New York City in 1901. And the first leader of that was actually Dr. Simon Flexner, who was from the University of Pennsylvania, a brilliant pathologist whose brother Abraham was critically important in the Flexner Report, which revolutionized American medical education, which at the time had really been very much on folk remedies and no really professional scientific basis. This basis grew in stature, and Paul Lewis, who was originally at the Rockefeller, moved to the Henry Phipps Research Institute in in Philadelphia after first discovering while at Rockefeller that the cause of polio was a virus, and actually developed a vaccine in monkeys. Of course, then the pandemic hit, and all of these really incredible scientists were mobilized to help in the military, and then obviously became involved in trying to deal with this horrible pandemic. And once again, Paul Lewis was then in Philadelphia, worked very hard to try and isolate the organism that was responsible for the pandemic. People didn't know. They thought it was some bacteria. There was a famous German pathologist named Pfeffer who had Pfeffer's bacillus, and they thought that this was the cause. And Paul Lewis spent much of his critical times in science trying to prove that this bacillus was the cause of the pandemic. And it turned out that he then moved to Yale and went to Brazil, where he died trying to find the cause of yellow fever and treat it, unfortunately. One of the people he had worked with, Richard Shope, then went on in the 1920s to show that influenza, they had an outbreak of this pandemic in pigs, and using the techniques that were developed by Lewis, Shope was able to isolate the influenza virus in the 1920s and show that this was the agent that caused the great pandemic. So this book is marvelous in so many regards, and Dr. Pemberton was part of this great time. So what I want to talk about this evening is our challenge. And the challenge is to achieve therapeutic outcomes in psoriatic and rheumatoid arthritis, but I'm going to speak about mainly psoriatic tonight, that are of similar magnitude to those observed with the newer biologic agents in psoriasis. And let me expand a little bit on that. So here's a slide, courtesy of Jose and Ian, in which it compares the phase 3 trial results in psoriatic arthritis at the top and psoriasis at the bottom with the same agents that we're all very familiar with. And one can see here that the ACR20 responses have really not changed since Philip Mies' first phase 2 trial of etanercept in 2001. And our ACR70 results are not very impressive either. However, compare that to the PASI 75 results over time, which have shown a steady increase, as you can see, and also the PASI 90. So why is it that we're seeing such poor responses in psoriatic arthritis in comparison to what were observed in psoriasis? And this is where the needs are, obviously, increasing the ACR70 and other outcome measures in psoriatic arthritis. So one of the reasons is there's tremendous tissue heterogeneity. So we have processes going on in the skin, the bone marrow, the gut, the enthesis, and the joints. And many of these pathways, while they have some similar characteristics, are not identical and may not be overlapping as much as we think. A very fine study by Belasco that looked at the transcriptome in the skin versus the joints showed that in psoriatic skin, it was really driven more by IL-17 pathways, whereas the joint was driven more by TNF. And so we have to think a little bit differently, that one agent is going to be incredibly effective at trying to deal with all of the various tissue pathologies that are present in this disease, in contrast to the psoriasis alone. The other complexity is with our patients. So we know that they can present with multiple domain involvement. And the domains are shown here, the arthritis, skin and nail disease, axial disease, dactylitis, enthesitis. And Electus Ogdi at Penn has shown beautifully in a recent study of the Corona database that patients often present with two or more of these domains, which really complicates the diagnosis and management of psoriatic arthritis, which is different than what we see in psoriasis. However, comorbidities, which are very common in psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis, pretty much overlap. So we can't blame the lack of efficacy in PSA to the comorbidities per se, although they certainly can very much influence how an individual patient responds, particularly in those patients who have BMIs that are greater than 35 or have severe diabetes or are very challenging in terms of trying to obtain remission in their joint and skin disease. well, why are we in this quandary in PSA? We have this huge PSA treatment toolbox that includes agents over on the left that we know, biologic agents, adjunct therapies, and now there are all these new therapies that are shown here in the right-hand corner. The most recent one that was approved was guselkumab, the antibody to IL-23. So why are we here and what can we do to improve on these outcomes despite the presence of so many different treatment options? So Jose and I wrote a paper on this last year and we identified some potential solutions and they're shown here. I'm going to focus on just a few of them tonight. That is, we could identify a new pathway or cell subset to focus our attention on in order to improve our outcomes. We can turn to precision medicine, which is gaining all sorts of new insights into the key cells and molecular pathways and epigenetics that are involved in our diseases. How about earlier intervention or at the stage of preclinical disease? In other words, treating those psoriasis patients at risk to develop arthritis before they develop musculoskeletal disease, and then a bit on lifestyle modification, which is still a very important area and one which my division is trying to move forward in but has many challenges. So what I want to talk about in terms of potential solutions to you this evening are CD8-positive T-resident memory cells, a fascinating cell subset that may be very much involved in both the skin and joint disease. And then osteoclasts that are resident to the synovial tissue. These are different than the osteoclasts that are in other areas of the body that are responsible for normal bone remodeling in all of us. These osteoclasts home to the synovium and are responsible for the pathologic bone resorption that we observe. I'm going to talk about weight loss and intermittent fasting, a very trendy topic right now, with some fascinating data about the effect of intermittent fasting on our immune system, and then talk about our efforts going forward in preclinical intervention. And then lastly, to close out, talking about therapeutics. And my emphasis tonight is going to be on some new treatment options, but most importantly, on head-to-head trials. And this is something we've not seen yet much in psoriatic arthritis, and yet they're coming of being. And I think it's important for me to highlight some of the recent data on head-to-head trials that was presented at the EULAR meeting a few months ago. So I'm going to talk about these two new cell subsets that I think are going to lead to some novel therapeutic approaches, the CD8-positive T memory cells and tissue-resident osteoclasts. So you're probably aware of this paper that was published several years ago, ANR, by Bruce Kirkham's group in London. And basically what they did is they went into the synovial fluid of patients with PSA on the top and RA on the bottom, and they looked at the cell populations that were in the synovial fluid. And you can see that PSA, the cell populations were CD4 negative, CD8 positive. They were more frequent in the synovial fluid and very low in the peripheral blood, whereas in patients with RA, and these cells are characterized by the expression of IL-17, they were not present in the blood or the synovial fluid in either cell subset. In this paper, they went on to show that this population, meaning the CD8 positive, IL-17 expressing cells, were correlated with elevated CRP, SED rate, and DAS-28. Whereas the CD4 positive T cells were not correlated with these important outcome measures. And they also went on to show that the CD4 negative population, CD8 positive, was associated with changes on power Doppler ultrasound in PSA, which was not observed with the CD4 populations. Well, this paper we thought was really transformative and changed our thinking about what cells in the T cell repertoire might be those most important to focus on. And I'm going to tell you what I think these cells are might be. And this has got to do with a cell subset of CD8 expressing cells called T resident memory cells. And I'm just going to give you a little bit of a background on these fascinating subset. So if you take and you scarify a mouse's skin, you scratch it and take away some of the epidermis and place vaccine on the skin, what will happen is that you'll have an infection at the site where you scarified and put on the virus. And at that site, you have the development of a subset of cells called T resident memory cells. Now, these cells are highest at the site where you place them, but they tend to circulate, and they're also present throughout the skin surface over a very short period of time, although in lesser numbers. I'm going to tell you more about these cells in a moment. So if you have a local skin infection, again, with this vaccinia infection, what will happen is you'll have the local skin infection, but these cells then circulate out, not the T-resident memory, but other T-cells, and then they give rise to T-resident memory cells that then can provide protection against pulmonary challenge, even though the virus was introduced in the skin. And you can also see this in the mouse if you do similar experiments, where the T-resident memory cells that were introduced in the skin can also develop to the same virus in the gut and in the lung and give partial protection against lethal pulmonary challenge. So what about these T-resident memory cells? Well, they express CD69, and a subset expresses CD103. CD69 keeps the cells in the tissue and prevents them escaping because of this molecule called CYP. They provide rapid on-site response and reactivation to a particular antigen, and the highest number at sites of primary activation. They are long-lived, but they do not recirculate. They stay in the resident tissue, and they tend to be antigen-specific. So in the skin, they react to staph epidermis, candida, HSV, gut, salmonella, rotavirus, and lung influenza and mycoplasma. So why am I spending so much time on this cell populace? So the fact is that they can be both protective, as I've just outlined for you, or they can be inflammatory. So one can see in the setting of certain antigen stimulation, the development of a pathogenic set of T resident memory cells that can be important in allergens, injury, and autoantigen. And this is beautifully reviewed in this paper by Rachel Clark from Harvard, who's a dermatologist investigator, who's really greatly increased our understanding of this important set of T cells. So what's the clues to the importance of these cells in psoriasis? Well, we know that psoriatic lesions tend to recur in the same locations, as do, by the way, joint flares. We know that E-selectin blockade is ineffective in psoriasis treatment, and E-selectin blockade will focus on circulating cells in the bloodstream. Non-lesional skin grafts transplanted to immunodeficient mice develop psoriasis. And let me give you a little more insight into this very important experiments that came from Frank Nestle's group. So basically, they took non-lesional skin grafts from patients with psoriasis. So these had no psoriatic plaques on them. They transplanted them to these immunodeficient mice. And these mice went on to develop psoriasis that was stimulated by the T cells were in those xenografts from the psoriasis patients. And when they went on to examine the cells that were driving this, it was a CD8 cell population coming from the human tissue. We also know that gene profiles in inactive and non-lesional skin show abnormal gene activation. So even though you don't see anything on the visual inspection of the patient, there's a lot of activity going on in these skin areas that are driven by T cells. And these are CD4 positive that release interleukin 22 and CD8 positive cells that release IL-17. And they persist in these areas. And it turns out that these CD8 cells are T resident memory cells. So Rachel Clark's group went on to look at these clones that were in both active psoriasis lesions on the left, and they did high throughput sequencing of the alpha beta receptors on the T cells. And then they compared this to what they saw as in resolved lesions, which are shown here and here. And here's a case of a patient with mycosis fungoides. Look at the clonality here, look at the polyclonality here, and the lower numbers of elevated clones of T resident memory cells in resolved lesions compared to active, although still quite a number. And when she went on to sequence these and compare what she saw in the active lesions versus those that were resolved, she found that there was oligoclonal alpha beta receptors, 15 TCR beta and 4 TCR alpha, but not gamma delta T cells. And there's been a lot of work on animal models of psoriasis and looking at gamma delta T cells, probably not important in humans based on these data. And what she saw was shared TCR sequences that were seen in the psoriasis patients, but were not observed in any control skin. And these were present in both lesional and non-lesional skin. So basically what this is saying, this is situated in the skin of psoriasis patients, both where the plaques reside and where they don't reside, are CD8 T resident memory cells that are poised to react and stimulate the formation of plaques. So what do we know about CD8 T cell differentiation in autoimmune disease? A very fine review by Petrelli. And what you see here is that they can have both a mixed pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory phenotype with these different receptors, which you've all come to know. I'm going to focus on PD-1 and Gramzyme B. These are markers of sometimes what we call an exhausted T cell, which has really been present in chronic cancer lesions or inflammation, and can no longer mount an activated phenotype. But it turns out that these tissue resident memory cells that express CD69 and CD103 can also express Granzyme B and PD-1, and they do not have an exhausted phenotype. Indeed, they have a pathogenic phenotype characterized by the release of interleukin-17. And these cells are present in psoriatic synovial fluid. Same group that I showed you at the beginning, more recent paper published in ANR in 2019. And you can see that these IL-17 CD8 positive cells that have the T resident memory phenotype are present in PSA, not RA, and also to a lesser degree in some patients with spondyloarthritis. And here again, we see these the different markers that characterize this cell population. Predominantly present in the CD8 cell population, although some CD69 are CD4 positive. And here you can see that these CD8 cells that are in the T resident memory category express a number of inflammatory cytokines, and they are truly polyfunctional. So we went on and looked within synovial tissue of psoriatic arthritis patients shown here, and we stained with CD8 in green, CD103 in white, CD69 in red, and these DAPI is a nuclear stain. And what you can see here, and this tissue is courtesy of Leahy Eder in Toronto, is that there's a marked infiltration of CD8 CD69 positive cells with some CD103 as well in the synovial tissue. And then you can see those that are double positive here on close-up. So these cells are in psoriatic synovial tissue, and we are now working on ways to target them. And we think that this could be very important in preventing recurrence of disease and even suppressing active inflammation. So the other cell population I want to talk to you about has been an area of interest of my laboratory, along with collaboration with Dr. Eddie Schwartz in the Center for Musculoskeletal Research for several years. And we know that osteoclast precursors are elevated in the circulation of patients with psoriatic arthritis. But this group went on to really drill down and try and figure out what are those osteoclasts that are present in the joint. And to do that, they took the collagen-induced arthritis model. They actually went in and cut out the area where the synovial membrane is inflamed, which is really phenomenal. And then using some cell sorting techniques with flow cytometry, they separated a variety of populations of cells. And it turned out that this population had characteristics of an osteoclast precursor population. And they went on and divided those into three populations, R1, 2, and 3. And I'm not showing you the data because it's way too complex, we don't have time, but they show that the R1 population was present in the bone marrow of these mice, and it expressed CX3CR1 low, LYC6 high. This was the marker. But when these cells were released from the bone marrow and went into the circulation, they took on what we call an R2 phenotype, where they could then become important as developing into monocytes, also leading to development of inflamed polymorphs. But most importantly, when exposed to MCSS and RANK ligand, they formed an osteoclast that was driven by the transcription factor FOXM1, which is very important in cancer and epithelial mesenchymal normal cell transformation. And it was this population that was driving osteoclasts in the peripheral joint. And they called this this R3 population an arthritis-associated macrophage because it's only seen in the joint. It's not seen in other areas of the body. They then went on to see if they could block FOXEP1, this transcription factor, in order to see if that was really instrumental in the formation of the osteoclast. And they used this in antagonist thiostreptan. And you can see that as they increased the dose of the antagonist to FOX1, the degree of joint damage went down. So the reason that I'm spending a little time on this is again, tissue resident osteoclasts. I've just shown you tissue resident T cells, and these are the kinds of cells that we're going to need to target in order to improve our treatment responses, both in RA and PSA, because focusing on circulating cells may not provide the same kind of response, although certainly more data will need to be obtained to support that idea. I should also say they isolated this population in rheumatoid arthritis patients, which is the analogous population to what we see in the murine model. So the other area that we've been working on is trying to understand why patients flare. And our focus so far has been in rheumatoid arthritis. And we published an article in ANR this month and looking at the ability of patients with rheumatoid arthritis in the hand to have normal or increased lymphatic flow in order to remove cells from the joint, the inflamed joint. And so in order to really explore what we had seen in mice, we developed an imaging technique using idocyanine green imaging. And this was work that was carried out, led by Eddie Schwartz. And then we had a team that involved myself and Richard Bell and Mark Kenny, Echo Buta, and Ron Wood. And the idea here, Homaya Rahimi as well, is that you inject the web spaces with this endocyanine green, I'll call it ICG for ease, and then what you can do is you'll see in a moment that this ICG moves from the soft tissues and into the lymphatic vessels. And you can follow this over time and various time points to see how readily the ICG clears from these finger pads here. I should say we've also injected the joints and used MRI and found that there's both a superficial lymphatic drainage system and one that is deep. So using this approach, we've been able to study RA and control patients. Again, you can see this paper in ANR this month. So up down below, you have your RA patients at baseline. And then here we see the second visit. And here we see a control patient and then the second visit. And what's really remarkable is that compared to the control patients where you're seeing in all of them a steady decline, that the RA patients, for the most part, you see retention of the ICG so that lymphatic vessel contractions and transit of the ICG is not happening. So what we think might be occurring in the rheumatoid joint is that the inability to clear inflammatory cells in the joint may be critical in not only the persistence of the disease, but the exacerbation of flare. This process is driven by nitric oxide, meaning the contraction, and we're trying to better understand how we can augment the contraction of these lymphatic vessels to clear the joint. So I would be remiss if I didn't comment on this remarkable paper from a few weeks ago from Dana Orange Group and Bob Darnell at Rockefeller, where they basically used some serial testing of a patient's to try and understand when patients were flaring and did some really novel transcriptomics in single-cell RNA-seq, and showed in this paper that flare was preceded by upregulation of a subset of B cells and then the release of mesenchymal cells. And so there are many approaches now coming to understand flare, and I think it's really exciting and an area that has really been under investigated. So what about another approach? What about trying to identify preclinical high-risk patients with psoriasis before they develop arthritis and treat them? So we know from this paper of Will Tillett's that if you look at patients, and this is from the UK Clinical Practice Research Data Link, you look at psoriatic arthritis patients before they develop psoriatic arthritis, that the majority of them have psoriasis before the diagnosis of arthritis. So this provides a marvelous opportunity for us to intervene if we can only identify those 30% of patients with psoriasis that are destined to develop arthritis. And we know that there is this transition that about 3% of the American population develops psoriasis. And we know then that there's key elements that happen in about 30%, which include genetic risk alleles, perhaps the microbiome in the skin or the gut, and then activation of osteoclast precursors, Th17, and other effector cells, some of which I believe I've just described to you, that result in the phenotype of psoriatic arthritis. And so, most, as I've already illustrated, have psoriasis prior to PSA. So psoriasis is really a great biomarker that we can focus on. And what we know is that from Leahy Eder's data in Toronto, that about 3% of psoriasis patients per year go on to develop psoriatic arthritis. Unfortunately, this is too small a conversion rate to develop an interventional clinical trial. So we've been trying to understand risk factors that we can use to enrich this targeted population. And you can do this by thinking about patients that are at risk and to predict progression and prevent psoriatic arthritis. So these are the factors we've identified and they're outlined in this paper shown below. And that they include certain biomarkers, obesity, first-degree relatives with psoriasis or PSA, and then most importantly is musculoskeletal inflammation by ultrasound that's subclinical. And so we are working on the, and also nail disease inverse psoriasis and severity of psoriasis. So we think that we can use these risk factors to identify these patients and then intervene. And we're proposing an interventional trial as shown here. We're picking interleukin-23 antagonists because we think that's very critical in the earlier stages of the disease, whereas TNF and IL-17 may be more at the effector level. So the idea here is to have three arms. One arm receives the IL-23 antagonist at baseline, the other one 6 months later, and then have a standard of care group, patients that elect not to go on biologics or systemic agents, and there's very many of these in our derm practices, and follow them with the co-primary outcome being number one, the change in the ultrasound signals at 6 months and 1 year in all three groups, and then the co-primary outcome later would be at 2 years and would be development of PSA by the Casper criteria. To get into the study, you would have to have a duration of psoriasis of more than 2 years, have more than 3% body surface area, and you would have to have a threshold of power Doppler abnormalities in the absence of any clinical joint symptoms. So we are now in the process of, we've written the protocol and we hope to move forward on this study in the first quarter of 2021. I'll keep you posted. So the plague of our patients, obesity. This is such a problem in our clinic, and I'm sure it is in yours, particularly with the psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis population. So this was a really phenomenal study that was published by Klingberg. It's in rheumatology, this particular one. I didn't update that. But she took 41 patients with PSA and a bone BMI greater than 33, and she put them on this incredibly strict diet, as you can see, for 12 to 16 weeks. And as a result of this very energy-restricted diet, they lost a median of 18.7 kilograms, and the BMI decreased dramatically, as shown here. And the percentage of patients achieving MDA went up from 29 to 54%, which is a truly incredible number. Now, if you look at the table over on your right, you can see the variables that were analyzed. You see that this was actually a pretty mild population, actually. But nonetheless, they achieved significant improvements in all of these outcome measures. And so we were really impressed with these data. But even more impressive, she went on to show a 12-month follow-up in the same population. So these patients did not continue that very low-energy diet. They've had them on a supervised dietary regimen, which was much more calorie-friendly, but still somewhat restricted. And you can see that over the 12 months, that most of the patients stayed in the study. Remember, it was 44 before. And once again, they maintain these incredibly improved outcome measures for arthritis and psoriasis, and also look at the change in their cardiovascular risk factors. So there is no doubt that based on these data and some other studies, that if we can get our patients to lose a fair amount of weight, that we can influence not only their inflammatory joint and skin disease, but also their cardiovascular risk. So another area that's come into popularity is intermittent fasting. Now, I should say that this review article in the New England Journal by DeCabo came out right before Christmas, which my family and friends said was a very cruel mistake, especially when you look at the approach one can take. So his argument is that intermittent fasting, which I'll outline for you in a minute, should be something that's really elemental in medical education for physicians, dietitians, and nurses, and it's very important for changes in centers that emphasize lifestyle changes. And you know, he's just giving a sample prescription here about how one could go about looking at this intermittent fasting. It has to do with combining, decreasing the time that you're actually feeding from 10 hours to 6 hours, and decreasing the caloric intake 1 or 2 days a week to a fairly dramatic low level. And the reason that there's a lot of pretty interesting data to support this approach, which he outlines in this review, and the idea here is that when you have intermittent fasting, the body is not so consumed on trying to digest various elements that are come out of our diet when we're eating. And so instead of focusing on digestion, they can focusing on recycling cells and maintaining homeostasis. So here you're seeing, you know, triglycerides are then broken down into free fatty acids. They can go into the liver where they can be transformed into FGF21 and acetoacetate that when feeds into the Krebs cycle. And as a result, one can see increased ATP production, an increase in mitochondrial biogenesis, a decrease in the mTOR pathway, which is a pathway that is a real problematic from a nutritional standpoint when activated, improved performance and stress resistance, and then also important in a neurogenic processes such as brain-derived neuropeptide signaling and synaptic plasticity and neurogenesis. So there's a lot of data on this in both animals and some in humans. Vachter Longo, L-O-N-G-O, has a book called The Longevity Diet. He's a nutrition scientist at USC. Very interesting data. So okay, great. So we restrict our diet. Well, what's the mechanism? So this was a paper that came out last year I thought was particularly fascinating. And so what they did is they asked the question, what is the effect of fasting on monocytes in humans? So they took humans and they allowed them to eat. And then for 3 hours, they had no food. They were allowed then to eat again. And then the food was restricted for 19 hours. And then they drew a second blood sample. They then performed CyTOF to separate the blood samples by their cell subsets. And you can see the various cell subsets they were able to identify. The next question they asked was, okay, what does fasting do to any of these cell subsets? And the answer is dramatic. So these on the y-axis on the left are percent number of monocytes. And you can see here in, after they've eaten and then after they fasted. And you can also see the number of CD14/16 positive monocytes, an inflammatory cell population, and the number of neutrophils, which did not change, but the monocyte populations dropped precipitously. You can see how significant this is after only 19 hours of fasting. They then went on and looked in mouse models, and they showed here that when you fast the mouse, that inflammatory signals that are seen in the blood cells go down dramatically. And this is quite impressive. And those cells are associated with homeostasis and, I would say, rejuvenating aspects of what the body does go up. It's PPAR alpha is thought to be driving some of these responses to feeding, as you'll see in a moment. And you can see here that when they have a PPAR gamma knockout mouse, that the changes that one sees in the inflammatory profile is not nearly as high as the wild type on the left. So short-term fasting resulted in a decline in monocyte metabolic activation, impaired egress from bone marrow, and this probably they showed had to do with CCL2, that's driving the release of the monocytes from the bone marrow, and that's driven by 5' AMP kinase, which is in the hepatocyte. So there's this link between the hepatocyte biogenesis and what's happening in the bone marrow, which I think is really fascinating and brings forth that first early slide I showed you about the relationship between all these tissues and inflammation in PSA. What's really interesting is they saw no compromise in emergency monocyte mobilization during the infection inflammation. So you didn't have monocytes that impaired egress when you needed them. They also showed decreased inflammation in this diet in an EAE model of a mouse model. So fascinating and providing some support for this approach. So now I'm going to talk about therapeutic advances moving to the different area on the emergence of head-to-head trials in PSA. And this is a new element in our armamentarium, and I think it's really exciting. And I'll tell you why as we move forward here. So this is the SPIRIT head-to-head 24-week trial, ixekizumab versus ADA in PSA patients not naive to bio-DMARDs. And you can see here that it's 52 weeks, so but the primary outcomes are 24 weeks. And it's a large population, and they looked at both joint and skin outcomes. The primary outcome was the ACR50. And what's really incredible is that these two agents completely overlap in their joint outcome measures. As expected, to the right, the PASI 100 is higher in the patients that got ICSI. And then when you use a co-primary outcome measure, which is the ACR50/PASI 100, using non-responder imputation, you can see there is a benefit to ICSI over ADA. And once again, if you look at the ACR 20, 50s, and 70s, they're completely overlapping. So this was interesting and showed that the 17 blocking agents have equal efficacy to adalimumab on the joints, but not the skin. This is another study, but this was presented at EULAR. The previous one was, I think, it's either in press or recently published. And this is a select PSA2 trial. This is upadacitinib. And what's most important about this study is this was performed in patients who had been intolerant to one or more biologic DMARD, all of them. So it's 641 patients randomized to placebo versus 15 or 30 milligrams of UPA. And you can see here the ACR20 primary endpoint, and these numbers are very respectable, particularly since it's a bio-DMARD in a tolerant population to anti-TNFs, ACR50 and ACR70. The PASI scores look higher than we generally see with JAK-STAT inhibitors. And you can see here the 15 and 30 milligram, and also a reasonable resolution of enthesitis and dactylitis at week 24. The ACR responses were at week 12 and the PASI at week 16. They all, at EULAR, was a select PSA1, not a head-to-head, but still very informative. This is a very large trial with UPA, same 1-to-1-to-1, 1,705 patients. They were intolerant to non-biologic DMARDs, 82% on a concomitant DMARD. You can see here, again, very respectable separation between placebo and the ACR20, ACR50, and ACR70. Once again, the skin responses are very quite good for an oral medication. And again, you can see the resolution of enthesitis and dactylitis is got reasonable separation at week 24. These data are at week 12, again, 16 for skin. Here we see MDA achievement in patients that receive UPA 15 and 30. They achieved a significant minimally clinically important difference of the HACDI. They also saw us that the SHARP scores were improved significantly compared to patients that were receiving placebo. And here you have the event, SAE event profile listed here on this table. And what you can see is that the serious adverse events were clearly higher in the UPA group compared to the 15 milligram dose. So this is, we'll have to see where the approval goes for this. My bet is it's going to be in the 15 milligram for psoriatic arthritis. Of course, it's already approved for RA. This is the EXCEED trial, which was presented at EULAR. This was a very bold move by Novartis. This is a secukinumab versus adalimumab, 52 weeks, so a long trial, looking at musculoskeletal efficacy in biologic naive PSA patients. And to cut to the chase, the bottom result was that there was not a significant difference in the ACR20 response at week 52 between secukinumab and adalimumab. I must say that they used a multiple imputation approach. If they used a non-responder imputation, there was a significant difference. So it came close, but it did not beat adalimumab. One of the reasons was that the retention rate in the study was higher for secukinumab with a higher added dropout, and that probably influenced their statistical interpretation. They went on like they was done in the ICSI trial to look at skin and joint responses, combining them into ACR50 PASI 100. And once again, not unexpectedly, secukinumab is better outcomes for this combined skin and joint measure than adalimumab. Somewhat surprising to me is when you look at the treatment emergent adverse events through week 52, not that much difference between ADA and secukinumab, maybe even a little bit more, a little bit, you really can't say because there's not enough patients, but there are concerning signals in secukinumab, adalimumab, maybe a little more for secukinumab. So very important study that tells us that blocking IL-17 is as effective as adalimumab in blocking and inhibiting joint, improving joint responses better in the skin. So another really important study was the Discover 1 and 2 that were published in Lancet. So I won't go over those. And this drug, as I mentioned at the outset, had been approved for PSA. But in this study, they also looked at axial measures. And we know, as I'll show you in a moment, that in the EXCEED trial with secukinumab, they looked at axial measures. But in the past, as you know, there have been two studies, one IL-12-23 with ustekinumab and an IL-23 inhibitor with risankizumab in axSpA that basically showed no signal whatsoever, which was a real surprise because animal models using IL-23 as a stimulator of disease really showed that IL-23 was involved in axial disease. Well, in this study, they took patients, a subset of PSA patients, because they were really predominantly looking at peripheral arthritis. And these patients had presumed spondylitis based on imaging evidence of SI based on historical abnormal SI X-ray or MRI. And these were locally read in Discover One, or currently abnormal SI X-ray locally read in Discover 2. And you can see that these were about 28% of the total clinical trial population. And when they looked at the BASDAI spinal pain and modified BASDAI, looking at the Q4 and Q8 week of the guselkumab patients, they found that there were significant differences between what they observed in placebo. And they also looked at the BASDAI 50 and once again saw significant differences in this measurement compared to the placebo group. They also looked at the ASDAS and the ASDAS CRP and again showing these differences. And they found that these results were similar in the 1/3 of patients who were B27 positive versus the 2/3 who were B27 negative. So we discussed these data at length among my colleagues. And one of the areas we were unsure about was, well, how truly is this a measure of solely axial disease in a patient that has a high peripheral arthritis burden? And we weren't sure. It's difficult to say. Certainly, if these data are confirmed in other studies and other outcome measures, it might suggest that the axial disease in psoriatic arthritis is different from what we see in axial SpA. And that itself is fascinating and will generate a whole new area of inquiry. But we'll have to wait to see if that proves to be the case. So the last study I'm going to talk about is MAXIMIZE. This is secukinumab. And this is looking at patients with axial PSA as identified by rheumatologists. And these patients did have MRIs at baseline and at week 12. They were treated with secukinumab, and they had those patients that were treated with 150 or 300 milligrams in a study that was previously presented, and I believe about to be published or recently published, showed that those that received secukinumab had significant improvement in outcome measures compared to the placebo. And now we have the MRI results. They used the Berlin scoring system. And you can see here that compared to placebo, there was a significant change in the Berlin score in both doses at week 12. But what was really interesting, aside from these findings, was that the ASAS-40 response at week 12 did not differ in those patients who were MRI positive or MRI negative. I'm not sure what that means, but it's certainly interesting and is going to bear further inquiry. So our MRI evidence of improvement to maximize and clinical response independent of MRI positivity. So to summarize, I've tried to provide you some potential approaches to improving our outcomes in psoriatic arthritis through better understanding of tissue effector cell populations, including CD8 T resident memory cells and arthritis associated tissue macrophages that mediate both inflammation and destruction, to talk to you about weight reduction programs and intermittent fasting and showing you that these can be very effective and potential mechanisms, to talk about preclinical intervention to treat psoriasis, which may ameliorate severity or prevent onset, and that's prevent, not present, onset of PSA. And then lastly, how head-to-head therapeutic trials are helping us understand the relative efficacy and safety of the agents that are out there in the biologic area that will hopefully help us to better individualize how we're going to treat patients based on their presenting features and comorbidities. I would like to point to you all to Room for Science. This is a great basic science program on the ACR website, 15-minute vignettes, case-based, that drill down to scientific principles that are great for fellows or attendings or people in practice. So please take a look. It's free. And then I want to thank the people in my division and the Center for Musculoskeletal Research, where our labs are located, who have really been instrumental in our ability to carry out the studies we do and have been really inspiratory, very inspiring for me in my career. And also, obviously, research support. So with that, I thank you very much and happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Richlands, for such a fascinating talk on frontiers in psoriatic arthritis, on emergent disease mechanisms and new directions in therapeutics. I am going to screen for questions from the audience. So do type in your questions and I'll read it. So far, I don't see anything. I will give you.
I have a question. I have a question here from Peter. Hi, Peter. Oh, I wish I could see you. So Peter's question is one that's we've been really struggling with, and the question is: you describe different cells pathways in different tissues. How about different cells pathways at different stages of PSA or SPA? And my own belief is that, yes, this is critical. And so I sort of showed that longitudinal figure that Alexis and Jose and Joe and I put together. And the implicit understanding behind that longitudinal roadmap to PSA is that at different stages, we've got different cells and cytokines that are driving this. And we believe, based on what we have from animal models and what we see in humans, that the early phase of this is interleukin 23. And that's probably influencing cell populations in the skin that are somehow either traveling to the joint through the lymphatics or are already in the joint and have turned into T-resident memory cells is one approach. But this is certainly something we need to learn how to figure out. And Peter, as you know, with Alexis, we have a grant from the National Psoriasis Foundation to do just that in both animal models and longitudinal sampling in humans. So hopefully I'll have more answers for you next year, but it's a phenomenal question.
Dr. Richland, have you yourself tried the 5-2 intermittent diet, and how did it go if you tried it?
We have not. So one of the, you know, we have a combined clinic, as I do at Penn and other places. And one of our challenges has been to get a nutritionist to come to our clinic. And it's challenging because we need someone that we can work with. And so I finally was able to make that connection, and we are going to move into that effort. Absolutely, because we have found that weight loss clinics are marginally effective. We do have them through our endocrine division, but I can't say they've been very successful. Certainly to do intermittent fasting, you would have to be extremely motivated. But you know, we run into patients all the time where we've run out of options, whether we've gone through the biologics and we're stuck. And so, and they're, you know, they're having BMIs above 30. So we tell them, we need you to actively be involved with us, whether it's intermittent fasting or whether it's a very low calorie diet or whether it's going and having a surgical approach. You have to really think about how you're going to be a team player so that we can work to get you a better response.
So an audience asks, is there a rebound when you start to eat again in the proteins you measure?
I'm sorry, could you ask me that question again? I got stuck with my camera.
No problem. Is there a rebound when you start to eat again in the protein you measure?
Oh, yeah. So is there a rebound when you start to eat? You know, I'm not sure the answer to that question. I would have you take a look at both the DeCabo manuscript and also Vater Longo's book. When you say rebound, do you mean that they would gain weight rapidly or that they would lose the cellular benefits that I described?
Okay, the anonymous audience, please type in your, clarify your question further. Meanwhile, I'm gonna move on to Philip Cohen, who asks, what's going on the impaired lymphoid draining?
Oh, wait, one second. I'm sorry. Alexis answered me and said that in the Klingberg study, they did not see rebound. So good to know.
Great, yes. So yeah, Dr. Cohen says, what's going on with the impaired lymphoid draining in psoriatic arthritis? Does it precede inflammation related to the degree of inflammation? He remembers that Jay Analek shows something similar in arthritic rats, improved with rituximab.
Yeah, that was actually, Jen was with us on that study. That was work from our group where we showed that right before the development of the arthritis in the TNF transgenic mouse model, that the lymph node draining in the knee expands dramatically and takes on gadolinium. We were using MRI imaging then. And then right before the arthritis hits the joint, the lymph node collapses. So the lymph node collapse comes before the arthritis. And so we focused for many years on trying to understand the immunologic environment of that lymph node, looking at the B cells that were there and other cell populations. We treated the mice with anti-TNF, which was able to partially reverse the arthritis, and B cell depletion also did. But it turns out that the B cells that were present in the lymph node didn't differ in a collapsed or expanded. So then we moved on to look at the lymphatic vessels, and it turned out that the lymphatic vessel contraction, once the lymph node collapses, basically stops. So it's a vessel problem. And when we then did ultrastructural analysis of the lymphatic vessels in the mice, we found that they were severely damaged. So the endothelial cells were ravaged, the smooth muscle cells were in disarray. And so we think that TNF and maybe inflammatory cells that are binding to the lymphatic endothelial cells are causing damage to the lymphatic vessels, and that that's resulting in stasis of inflammatory cells in the joint and then a flare. We're now doing a lot of other studies in humans to recreate what we've done in mice in terms of looking at different stages of disease and trying to capture them during a flare. Much along the lines of what you saw with the Dana Orange story, but let me tell you, it's very complicated trying to capture patients in flare.
So next question, are there similar clinical data with weight reduction in rheumatoid arthritis by Arthur Hupper?
I don't know about RA. I do know, and Alexa maybe can comment as well, that there's certainly data in psoriasis patients with both bariatric surgery and weight loss showing improved responses of skin. And I showed you PSA. I honestly don't know about RA, although it would not surprise me. If anyone else knows, let me, you know, speak up.
So Alexis asks, what do you think are some of the critical next steps to improve outcomes for patients with psoriatic arthritis over the next 5 years?
I think the most important steps are going to be early intervention, and we've got to prove that that works. But if that is effective, I think that's going to be really important. I think that approaches to weight loss in the patients that are in the higher BMI group is going to be critical. And I think we've got to think more of a team approach, because in our combined clinics, I mean, beyond just the physicians, but again, nutritionists and dietitians who can come in and help us to administer the kinds of dietary changes, whether it be intermittent fasting or changing what they're eating, I think is really critically important. And then, you know, I'm hoping that there'll be some, through the use of precision medicine, we'll be able to drill down better on which agents are best for which patients. So those are the three things that I would say I'm looking to in the next 5 years.
Okay. And Alan Epstein wants to know, are you able to expand on the immunologic differences between axial psoriatic arthritis and axial spondy?
Wow. Super question. I would say to you that there are differences, and there's a really great review paper on this in Nature Reviews Rheumatology from 2 years ago. And there are certainly genetic differences. We don't see the high percentage of HLA-B27 in the PSA axial. There's more B8 present and more unilateral involvement than bilateral. I would say that in terms of the pathways that are leading to the inflammation in the axial skeleton in PSA versus XSpot, we do not know. I mean, it's a huge knowledge gap, and one we need to fully address. And I'm fascinated with the Discover data that I showed. I'm not sure the significance yet, but if it turned out that patients with PSA and axial disease responded to IL-23 blockade where patients with AXSpot did not, that would suggest a profoundly different underlying mechanism. And we'll have to see if that holds up and what we can learn about it.
Gotcha. Charles Pritchard wants to know, trauma seems to cause a flare or trigger joint disease in psoriatic arthritis. How does this fit into your model of disease?
Yeah, so I didn't talk about this. This is an area that's been studied extensively and still is studied extensively in Belgium and in Germany, and that is the role of biomechanical stress and inflammation. And this is where the entheses really come into play, because as you know, they're transmitters of stress to the bone and to the other structures that are around the joint. And it turns out in work that was published it was one of the Nature journals. And you've seen some of these data where they take, this is from Dirk Elawat's group, E-L-E-E-W-A-U-T, where they take mice and they run them with their hind paws up and their front paws on the bottom of the cage. And they're able to show in these arthritis models that the arthritis is much worse in the weighted paws. And now they've taken them, they've got them running treadmills and doing all sorts of interesting things, showing that these efforts, Nina, the pounding of the paws in the cage leads to inflammation and new bone formation that's present in very specific areas in the paw. They can also recreate data like this in humans with SPA by looking at certain areas in the foot where you see areas of biomechanical stress, and then you see new bone formation at those particular areas. It's in Nature Communications from 2019. Isabel Combray is a lead author. Great paper. So yes, so trauma can stimulate, probably through the enthesis, an inflammatory response, which is associated with erosion and new bone formation, probably accentuated in a B27 positive population.
All right, sounds like that's your excellent talk. You answered all the questions. Anybody else with questions for Dr. Richland? Okay, if that's the case, thank you so much, Dr. Richland. That was a fascinating talk. Once again, so thank you so much for giving us the wonderful talk. And just a reminder to everyone, our next clinical pathological conference will take place on February 9th, 2021, and further details will be coming in mid-November. So everybody have a good night and stay safe. Take care now.